get what you need sometimes, y'all. Give me the bridge now.
Welcome to Soccer Morning on NASN. Here's your host, Jason Davis.
Morning, everybody. Happy Wednesday. Jason Davis, Soccer Morning, North American Soccer Network, NASN.TV, SoccerMorning.com. Chuck Brown. Man, I love me some Chuck Brown. Music today, courtesy of Jonathan Tannewald. Man, you just got me flying off the star, John. Fantastic stuff. Chuck Brown, late great Chuck Brown, DC icon. Jonathan Tannewald, a good DC boy with some Chuck Brown there to start. It is Wednesday. We've got a lot to talk about. This is a big show. Herculez Gomez, in the 11 o'clock hour, will sit in with us for however long he wants to. It's open house for Herculez Gomez today. He'll be joining us later. I'm excited for that. We'll talk Tijuana. We'll talk MLS. We'll talk CBA, maybe. We'll talk soccer coverage on television, which is something that Herculez expressed an opinion on Twitter about, which I found fascinating. We'll talk some of that. The battle for SoCal. This is always that thing that happens when we talk Tijuana. Obviously, LA Galaxy, Paul Arriola, this notion that there's a push-pull between Mexico and the United States down in that part of the world, and obviously Herculez is in a great position to give us some insight into that. Let's go ahead and off the start, open up the phone line, 347-756-6276. Also on today's show, in a couple of minutes, as a matter of fact, David Cartledge, our friend who covers La Liga, will join us. We'll talk about what Real Madrid did to Bayern Munich yesterday, because that was, am I wrong to say evisceration? Am I wrong to say obliteration? Am I wrong to say not domination? I'm rhyming here. I don't really mean to rhyme. Clearly, Real Madrid executed their plan to perfection, both in the first leg at the Bernabeu and in the second leg at the Allianz Arena. Perfect, both times. Everything went their way, but clearly they set out with an idea in mind of how they wanted to play Bayern Munich, and it worked because they have the talent and they had the commitment, and they made their chances count. We can maybe talk about Cristiano Ronaldo and his 15-goal celebration, if you'd like. Perhaps we could do that. How did he do it? Like, there was hands involved. It was like jazz hands, kind of. What was going on there? This is on video for all time now. I'm on YouTube, having tried to do Cristiano Ronaldo's celebration. 15 goals in the competition in one season to break the record. Come on. You can't really hate on the guy for the record, and I'm not. I thought the choice of celebration was hilarious and ridiculous. Ridiculous in a fun way. Not ridiculous in a Cristiano Ronaldo should not do those type of things sort of way. Because I learned a lesson yesterday. I learned a lesson. If you criticize Cristiano Ronaldo in any way, shape, or form on Twitter, you're going to get a reaction. You're going to get a bunch of people coming at you. Let the guy do what he wants to do. Look how great he is. I agree. He's allowed to do it. I'm allowed to call it ridiculous. That's how this works. My opinion, that was a ridiculous celebration. But mostly because of the bounce. And how many people said immediately thought single ladies? How many people immediately did that? Raise your hand if you thought immediately he was trying to do some single ladies thing. My brain went to that, even though I knew he wasn't doing that. All right. So we got the phone lines open. We got David Cartledge in a couple of minutes. Not only will we talk Real Madrid and Bayern Munich, we'll talk about Chelsea, Atletico Madrid today. We'll talk about the La Liga race. We'll talk about what happened with Dani Alves. And we'll talk about the response and the situation in Spain as it relates to racist behavior on the part of the fans. And the culture in general. I mean, I'm not going to sit here and... Obviously, Spanish culture is not monolithic, just like most cultures aren't monolithic. But clearly, there's something in the Spanish culture that has brought this issue to the forefront in recent years. It's become, it's obviously always been there. But there's something, and I've said this, and I'm going to harp on it. I'm sorry, this is important. It's not about what Dani Alves did. It's about the situation in Spain that led that fan to think, this is something I'm going to do. The situation in Spain that led someone to think, I can get away with this. Now, they didn't, and the fan was banned. And I suppose that's some sort of resolution. But at the same time, it does not address the intrinsic issues in that culture. And again, every time racism comes up in world football, and we talk about it on the show, I make sure to say that the American sports culture is not perfect. But what has happened, and I once wrote about this in relation to the John Terry incident. I once wrote about this for 200%. Maybe I'll find the link. There is the American sports culture has evolved to the point where this behavior is not acceptable in any way, shape, or form. Now, we have had isolated incidents. I know that hockey's had one or two. We've had a couple of things happen over the course of a decade. But for the most part, in this arena, and obviously Donald Sterling's in the news, and that's an ownership issue, and that's a culture, an NBA culture issue with the owners and the players, and that's much, much bigger, much more important probably for the culture of that sport, but doesn't speak to in arena behavior on the part of fans. Because for the most part, American fans have said, okay, we're gonna push this issue to the side. It's not that there's not racism here, and yes, there is, and we need to fight it, and that's all of those things are important to say. It's that fans, for the most part, have eliminated that as a means of getting one over on the other team. That hasn't happened in Spain yet, and I'm not going to pretend to know why. Maybe David Carlich can give us some insight. Maybe not. Maybe it's just one of those difficult things. And how do you go about attacking? The other interesting thing about the response to the Dani Alves incident is his teammate Neymar setting off this firestorm of response via social media. You've seen the picture. Neymar's the guy who started the banana Instagram campaign. He's the guy that started it. It's apparently the result of a PR firm carefully orchestrating it. Now, Neymar's also responsible for the We Are All Monkeys hashtag, which he, of course, put in Portuguese. But I got a question, and I've seen plenty of response from people who I respect and whose opinion is valid in this situation, who said that they didn't like it at all, period. Trivializes the racism, trivializes everything that's going on here, doesn't let people really address the issue, sort of lets them focus on taking selfies. That's a legitimate opinion on this. And I've sort of taken a step back on the viral element of the backlash. Dani Alves and his response, I get that on a human level. Certainly can't identify with Dani Alves, I'll admit to that. But in light of the fact that this was a PR orchestrated campaign on the part of Neymar's people, does that take something away from it for you? If you were one of those people who enjoyed this because it was this community response to an ugly incident, which, by the way, isn't isolated. Let's not say isolated incident at Villarreal, because this is not isolated. It happens all the time. Sepp Blatter is chiming in now. And man, I've got some words for Sepp Blatter, too. I think we all got some words for Sepp Blatter, who wants to piggyback off of the NBA banning Donald Sterling and tweet about how he congratulates. Really, Sepp? This is the man who once said, a handshake can solve all of these problems. Yeah, no, don't think so. Let's take a break. When we come back, David Cartledge will join us. We'll talk about that big win for Real Madrid in Germany yesterday. Atletico going to Chelsea. Soccer Morning, North American Soccer Network, NASN.TV. Remember, Herculez Gomez, 11 o'clock.
Welcome back to Soccer Morning on NASN with Jason Davis.
Back on Soccer Morning, joined now by David Cartledge, our friend who covers La Liga. Hello, David. Sorry, let me just get rid of that music.
Hello there.
David joins us on a very interesting day in the world of Spanish football. Not only, well, it's an interesting time period, but not only do we have what Real Madrid did to Bayern Munich yesterday, and I'll admit that I may have underestimated Real Madrid's ability to be that good in Germany, David. It's not that I didn't think they could win or take the tie and advance to the final. Certainly had them as one of the favorites. I just didn't expect it to be that comprehensive. And the only way that I can say it, and I'm looking for your insight here, is that they got their tactics exactly right over both legs.
Oh, they did. It was just superb. It was on point in both legs. I think Ancelotti judged it absolutely magnificently. And the team values really came to the fore. And that was what triumphed, basically. I know we had two goals from Sergio Ramos. Ronaldo obviously played his part as well in the second leg, but no, it was definitely the team that came to the fore, and they absolutely dominated Bayern from the first leg right to the final minute of the second leg.
Again, it was essentially over at halftime, and I think that's part of what was stunning. You got the Sergio Ramos, both of those goals, and maybe you can say there's an element of surprise to the fact that he's the goal scorer that set them on their way. But certainly they realized, I'm sure, Ancelotti realized that Bayern Munich could be victimized on set pieces.
Yeah, definitely. As we say, tactically, he really identified everything. I mean, we know that Bayern have lots of strengths, but if we were to pick a weakness, it would be those two centre-backs. And last night it really showed. I think across the ground, you're able to get them as well. And I think that was showed when Madrid really put, across the course of the tie, Madrid really put pressure on the ball that was coming out the back. So from Neuer into Dante or Boateng, they really put pressure on there. So somebody like Benzema has put in an incredible shift across the course of the tie, and he really put pressure on those centre-backs. But as you say, we saw it at the set pieces as well, and Ramos is a wonderful player in the attacking zone, because the way he attacks the ball, he does it really without any care for the opponent. He sees that ball, his eyes are on that ball, and then he uses his power, or he's got his pace to attack the ball, and he's got a fantastic leap as well, and he's quite a competitor in the air, and Bayern know about that now.
You can always tell those guys who are great on set pieces, particularly defenders, who have that knack for it. Some guys go up and they jump, you know, they jump for the ball, they go vertical, and maybe they make contact and they'll score their fair share of goals. Those guys who attack the ball, and on the other end, Ronaldo is famous for attacking the ball with his head the same way. He gets the record for goals in a Champions League campaign. He does his silly celebration, which, again, it's silly. I understand why he's celebrating, and it's a remarkable achievement. But it's still silly, and you could tell. And he even had a moment there, David, where it looked like he might have been actually injured. What was did from what you saw? Did it look like he was injured? Was it a matter of I don't know? There was some emotion there. What was going on?
Yeah, I think it looked like he was. I think he really see. I think he really, because I mean, the force that Dante went into Ronaldo was massive. Because obviously you see lots of slow motion replays after, but if you were to replay that incident in real time, you'd look at the ferocity that that Dante has gone into that tackle, and he's stood as connected right with Ronaldo just above his ankle. And that is really connected with him. And then he's gone with pace, with lots of speed and with force as well. And I think Ronaldo was worried there for a second, definitely. Because with the World Cup around, if you go out injury where you're out maybe 6 weeks, you're looking at your World Cup's over.
Mm-hmm, absolutely. He comes back, scores twice. The first one on just the back-breaking counterattack. Gareth Bale playing provider. And that was sort of everything that is most dangerous. I mean, obviously you've got other players, Benzema and Di Maria and all of these, this talent in the team. But when you see Gareth Bale and Cristiano Ronaldo running a break at that speed with that perfection, I mean, that's, how can you stop it? How can you possibly stop it, David? Did I lose you? David, are you with me? I can hear David, but I don't think he can hear me anymore. This is not good. What's happening here? David. Hello. Okay. I'm not sure what's going on with David Cartledge. Let me see if we can we can hold on for a second. Maybe he'll come back. David, are you with me? Okay. We'll keep going here. Let's take a quick break. That's a good idea. Let's take a quick break. We'll figure this out. When we come back, we'll see if we can reconnect with David. I'm not sure what happened there. Skype being Skype. Soccer Morning, North American Soccer Network, NASN.TV, SoccerMorning.com. Stay right there. Be right back.
You might get what you're after. Cool, baby. Strange, but not.
Welcome back to Soccer Morning on NASN with Jason Davis.
Back on Soccer Morning, in a momentary technical interruption, but we do have David Cartledge back on the line, and I'm pretty sure he can hear me. David, can you hear me?
Yes, loud and clear.
Now, I was extolling the virtues of that break, the counterattack that Cristiano Ronaldo scored the record-breaking goal on, with the help of Gareth Bale, and the two of them bearing down on a defender and a goalkeeper. It's sort of everything that embodies what Real Madrid can be and is right now. That is one of the scariest. It's going to be one of the scariest situations for a defender and a goalkeeper in the world, right there.
Yes, certainly, it really did. That move did encapsulate all what's fantastic about Real Madrid. I think, as well as the traditional hallmarks of a good counterattack, you know, the pace and the power. And how quick the players move up the field together as well. But also, Madrid's got this wonderful precision now in midfield. You've got Xabi Alonso and you've got Modric there who can hit that pinpoint pass into a danger area straight away, hit that ball just over the halfway line, and it sets you away. You've got people like Di Maria and Ronaldo and Bale on rushing, and then Benzema as well. And, you know, you've got those four running at you, and then maybe midfielder and support, and at the end, like you said, it's I think it's probably the most frightening sight in the world. It's a spectacular sight, but I think if you're an opponent, as you say, I think it's the most frightening sight in football right now.
Yeah, if I'm not mistaken, Xabi Alonso is going to miss the final yellow card accumulation. Is there anybody else who Real Madrid will be missing, or is he the only one?
No, he's the only one. The only other one that was dangerous was Sergio Ramos, and there was people imploring Ancelotti to take him off, but he managed to last until Varane came on later on. So I think he showed a lot of restraint there, Ramos. Everybody's always a bit concerned because sometimes his head can go elsewhere, shall we say, being played.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, Real Madrid, obviously, Champions League final, fantastic achievement for them, sort of the bar where they want to be every season. They are still 6 points back in the title race in La Liga with a game in hand on Atletico Madrid. Meanwhile, Atleti is in the semifinal second leg against Chelsea at Stamford Bridge today. And we saw what Real Madrid managed to do to Bayern Munich in the first leg. We saw what Chelsea and Atletico, you know, we saw what happened in that first leg. What do you expect out of this return leg at Stamford Bridge? How is Chelsea going to attempt to attack Atletico Madrid, and how do they hold out?
I think Chelsea's going to be very patient. I don't think they're going to go hell for leather at Atleti. I think both teams will score for a start, but obviously I think Chelsea will see this one through. I think this might be just a bridge too far for Atleti. I mean, they've only conceded five times at Atleti in the Champions League this season. Three of those goals have come away from home. So you can see a little weakness there, and I think Chelsea having got an important win over the weekend as well, I think that would have boosted the whole squad, and then the people who were coming back who will be fresh for this game, And I think it just plays. I think again, it's going to be another Mourinho tactical job, perfection job. And then Atleti can focus wholeheartedly on winning the league. And I think that will be seen as a fine success for them. But I think Atleti, this is just a bridge too far for them.
Now, it's interesting because whichever side comes out of that semifinal, now that we have Real Madrid locked in, it's going to be, the storylines are going to be fascinating either way. There you have the all-Spanish final and the chance for Atleti to do something absolutely amazing, whether they go on to win La Liga or not, and certainly that's within their grasp. Or you have Jose Mourinho against Real Madrid in his home country. I mean, there are so many things here. Which one is more attractive to you, David?
I think Simeone is going to want both. That's the thing. He's greedy. He'll want both. But I think the league is the most okay. important one. I think for Atleti.
Well, which storyline is more intriguing? Jose Mourinho's return, or going up against Real Madrid in the Champions League final if Chelsea get through, or an all Spanish final? Which one is more intriguing for you?
In that regard, I think an all Spanish final, definitely. I think that one's the more intriguing. I think because Spain's had such a grip on football at the highest level, and I think this will be the peak for them if they can get these two teams and get two teams together in a final. I mean, it's the first time since, I think, 1999-2000 when Real Madrid faced Valencia. That was the last time there was an all Spanish final, and I think it's important for Spanish football that they get this and they can really say, look, this is the era of our dominance with both national team and the club level. So I think that does, but I'm sure that won't sit well with Mourinho, but that's just how I see it.
Well, it's also interesting that that's sort of happening while the narrative is that Barcelona has taken a step back, and look, they are in a position where they can get back to the level that they were previously in some manner. But of course, Pep Guardiola is now at Bayern Munich. And let me, while we're still in talking Champions League, and I'm going to move us to Barcelona and the incident with Dani Alves in a moment. But while we're talking about Champions League, Pep Guardiola is, I don't know that there's a backlash. I don't know if this is one of those situations where people are claiming that he is getting criticism when maybe it's not as virulent as it might seem. But certainly there's a notion that Pep Guardiola, it's not working at Bayern because they crashed out of the semifinals against one of the best clubs in the world. That's amazing to me.
Yeah, it is. It's once again, it's the levels of extremes that people go to. I think when it comes to football, we saw it last week with Atleti Chelsea, when obviously there was a big debate over what style of football should be professed by a team who have spent a lot of money.
Right.
And then obviously this time around, we see with Pep, and again, people go to these extremes and say, look, he's playing the wrong way. And I don't think it's a case of that. We don't have to make these huge statements every time something like this occurs. I just think it could have been a smaller thing as simply the players not being out on the night and not playing to the Guardiola standards as they have been for much of the season. But I think they'll go away, they'll get stronger again. They've got Lewandowski coming in, and then they'll probably buy another two players, and then they'll come back. And I'm sure we'll tweak little things, so maybe there isn't a repeat from there. I think there was too many crosses went in. But the thing that struck me about last night, it wasn't really Pep Guardiola's football that Bayern were playing either. It was very urgent, it was very rushed, and Pep's never like that. He's always somebody who's emphasising calm on the ball and just, look, play your game. And they didn't play Pep's game or Bayern's game last night.
What?
I don't think the criticism is extreme.
Well, that's interesting that you say that, because I don't know that it was odd. It was interesting considering the scoreline. He brings off Mandzukic and puts in Javi Martinez, and that's in that situation that didn't necessarily strike you as something most managers would do. You're removing a striker for, but at the same time, maybe that was what you're speaking to. He wasn't happy with the way they were playing, and he needed that calmer influence there in Javi Martinez in order to get back to Bayern football, which again, they weren't able to do. And it was too high of a hill to climb, and that's understandable.
Oh, yes, certainly. And that's exactly what I was getting at. That change played into that. I think Pep could see it was far too rushed. It seemed like the start of the game was effectively the last 10 minutes of the game for them. And they were rushing the way they were pinging the ball about, the positioning, the taking a position in, the running. It wasn't the same as usual. It wasn't as methodical as before. It seemed all a little unorganized. And if Bayern are going to set out on that foot, then it's probably going to be the pattern for the rest of the game. And it was, and Real Madrid exploited it perfectly.
Now let's turn to Barcelona, and I'll specifically turn us to the incident with Dani Alves and the banana being thrown at him at Villarreal. And his response, I think, I've sort of given him credit for his response. I think that on his part, from a personal perspective, the way he responded is understandable, justifiable, perhaps even laudable in a way. But we've had this wider campaign, and I just talked about how Neymar's original banana Instagram photo was part of a coordinated PR campaign by people who worked for him. The response within Spain and sort of the notion for me, the more problematic issue, David, isn't the one fan at Villarreal who threw the banana. It's any culture that creates a situation where that's some sort of acceptable behavior. And we certainly have plenty of incidents of chance within Spain. What is the fundamental issue there? I don't know if you could boil it down all that far, but what is the condition in Spanish football, and does it reflect wider Spanish society?
Yeah, it does. It's a real issue for people coming from another country who are perhaps not being as tolerant towards it. They come here and they are very, very shocked at the acceptance. I mean, you look at the main TV shows after the incident and how they discussed it, and it was incredible. It was as if somebody threw, I don't know, maybe a plastic bottle off him. And I'm not saying that's not a serious incident or anything like that, but it was looked upon so lightly. And that is as sickening as the actual incident itself for me, because there is no inclination at all that there is going to be any change in terms of the view of racism in Spanish football, because simply put, the Spanish football community and the people who are at the top of it, be it the media, be it the powers that be in the RFEF, or anywhere like that, LFP, people who are involved within Spanish football, they simply don't take it seriously enough. And the country itself, outside of football, doesn't take it seriously enough either. There simply isn't that culture that exists. And we saw yesterday in the NBA, obviously, with everything that's happened, and we saw David Sterling removed straight away. You know, that was zero tolerance. You can see there is zero tolerance, and then there's acting out in terms of zero tolerance as well. And that was an action of zero tolerance for me. That wasn't just saying it. Somebody like Sepp Blatter has maybe said before, oh, we show zero tolerance towards racism. But do they? I think suggesting that you shake hands with the person who's... I think you suggested that you shake hands with the person who's given you racial abuse before.
Yes.
Which is just... it leaves me speechless, it really is. And I think there's got to be zero tolerance. Not just saying zero tolerance, there needs to be action
now,
in that regard.
Now, it's unfair, and this is part of what happened in the NBA as well, but it is unfair to put the burden of response on the person aggrieved, on Dani Alves. It's unfair to say, and this is why I'm sort of okay with what he did, eating the banana and sort of making light of it, because it shouldn't be his responsibility to point to the injustice in the stands or in Spanish culture or Spanish society. He but at the same time, perhaps we're to the point now, David, where it's going to take more than Kevin Prince Boateng walking off the field during a friendly in Italy. It's going to take a mass walk-off, solidarity among an entire team when incidents like these happen in games that matter, in order for someone to actually take notice and decide that we need to take drastic action rather than sort of dance around the subject. Let's form a subcommittee. We'll get a couple of black players on it. Everything will kind of go about, we'll go the same way it's been going for the last 25 years.
Yeah, I honestly couldn't agree more. I think before Dani Alves even took to his Instagram and his Twitter to post a picture or to post a video and to start this PR initiative, what's going around, people from the Spanish football, within Spanish football, should have been coming out and condemning it before he's even done that and shown support to Alves. They didn't, though. And nobody on the main TV shows here, which get a lot of viewers, and people, young generations take a lot of notice of. The viewings here are massive for these type of shows. They're not particularly intellectual in terms of their tactical content, but in terms of discussion, it's very, very popular, because it's just really popular. And a lot of young people, so we're talking 13 to 18, and maybe watching this, And that's what they sit there saying. They're seeing the main pundits in Spain discuss this and say that it's, you know, to say that, like, we shouldn't, this isn't the problem, basically, not accepting the problem. And, and that's bad. That is setting the trend for the future generations as well. And as you say, it should not fall on Dani Alves. You know, it's not up to Dani Alves to take a stand here. It should be, there should be people in support with him. And I'm not talking about posting a picture of the banana. I'm talking about serious sanctions. I'm not even talking about sanctions. I'm talking about just banning people, just throwing these people out straight away. And saying this can't happen. This is we can't tolerate this.
Again, it's sort of, while it is there is some justice in the particular fan, and I haven't seen his name, and I'm not sure it would matter for us here, but obviously shame is part of this. While it's justice that he is banned from the stadium and will never be able to come back, and they've been identified and all of those things, at the same time, that gives Villarreal and Spanish football the opportunity to isolate it to that one individual and still avoid addressing. And again, it's not just Spanish football. It's a wider culture that's mostly across Europe. I don't know that I've heard of an incident recently in any of the Americas where this has been a problem, although it may happen in South America and I'm not aware of it. Certainly Brazilian culture has some issues. American culture does too. We just don't bring it to our sporting events. This is something, again, that we need wider. And I don't know that we're going to come to any conclusions here, David. It's just the frustration is sort of pouring out. And again, Kevin Prince-Boateng does what he does, which I think is a justifiable and appropriate response in a friendly, and there's not as much at stake. And that's when Sepp Blatter comes out and sort of says, and again, the FIFA response isn't, well, let's back those players who might walk off in the face of racial abuse. It's, you're going to be fined, you're going to be punished, your team will forfeit that match. And that's not the right response.
No, definitely not. And this is the flip side of the coin, is if Barcelona do create a mass walk-off, people are going to say, oh, well, why should everybody else suffer? Why should the football stop? And why should nobody see the game? But I think it's going to take something, as you touched on, it's going to take something major like that before I think a proper debate actually is started. Because I think it's a bigger problem in Spain than it is a lot of European countries. But there's a complete there's an unwillingness to accept that and to just to take on board the argument. It's completely thrown away.
David Cartledge covers Spanish soccer. You can follow him, David JACA, on Twitter. He's all over the place and provides insights to us on a regular basis. I appreciate your time as always, David. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you. I've enjoyed myself.
Yeah, there you go. There's David. I appreciate David's time as always talking about Spanish soccer. And again, that gets heavy. But racism is heavy. Racism deserves to be exposed, deserves to be attacked. I know. I'm sorry. I'm not sorry. That's not what I meant to say. Not sorry at all that we talked about it. I'm sorry that it's happening. I'm sorry that Dani Alves has to spur an international discussion with his response. I'm interested to know. We'll open up the phone lines here. Remember, Herculez Gomez at 11 o'clock. Open up the phone lines. Does the fact that a PR firm played a role in Neymar's Instagram campaign and the We Are All Monkeys hashtag and all of these banana pictures that have exploded all over the internet, which again, on one level, is a show of solidarity with Dani Alves and with the notion that, look, we're all the same people. This is insane. Why are we continuing to do this? Like, it doesn't address anything in Spain. It doesn't address cultural issues. It doesn't address the fact that that person probably thinks it's still something that they're justified in doing, whether they are banned or not. I mean, that's the fundamental problem here, right? We're addressing the symptoms, not the cause. How do we address the cause? How does football address the cause? Should football have a responsibility to address the cause? It certainly should never, football as a construct, as a thing that exists in the world, and we're all part of the community. Football should, at the very least, make sure that players are not subject to these things, and that the response, when they are, is swift, harsh, and teaches that, look, you want to think this in your house? We can't change that. You're wrong. We can't change that. Do not bring it to the stadium. You bring it to the stadium, there's no games, or you're docked points. I mean, look, I even struggle a little bit of whether or not the team should be punished in light of fan behavior, but how else do you address this? You can identify that one fan, and you can ban him for life, but do you honestly think that that's a deterrent for another fan, whether it's at Villarreal or somewhere else, who decides to sneak a banana into a stadium? No, it's not. Again, because we're not talking about... on one level, this is typical tribalism. I'm going to get at this player for my team. But it's also a cultural problem that runs deeper than that, as David has suggested. I don't know. I'm frustrated. Rick, save me.
I have to absolutely agree with you. It's incredibly frustrating. And unfortunately, gestures like this banana photo thing and the We Are All Monkeys hashtag, it makes people feel better, but it's not going to affect any actual change. I think we saw a really compelling piece of evidence about this with the release today of some news that NBA players were going to walk off the court if they didn't feel that Donald Sterling's punishment was appropriate.
Right.
And that was one of the primary pressures that brought that punishment on the Sterling.
Wait, who did you say? It doesn't matter. I read a story that was the Warriors who were going to do that. Is that what you said?
The Warriors, and apparently the Warriors were talking with the other team.
Gotcha.
As of tip-off last night, they were talking about all the teams that were playing last night walking off.
Yes.
It's going to take something like that. It's going to take, entire teams walking off when bananas are thrown. What you have right now, we've got, over the last 24 hours, we've had MLS supporters groups, for example, doing the banana photo thing. We've had MLS players doing that. But have any MLS players or supporters groups said anything about MLS taking Etihad or Chick-fil-A as sponsors? Have has Cristiano Ronaldo, for all the attention he gets for his great play, has he ever come out and said, I am ashamed that the fans in stadiums I play in behave this way? Would someone of his stature with his marketing muscle ever walk off the pitch if one of his teammates had a banana thrown at them? We don't know that. And until something like that happens, the people governing the game aren't going to pay attention to it.
I agree on the drastic action, as I outlined with David. Where the line is on what is okay and what's not, and whether or not it touches the game again. We're talking about racism impacting the stadium, the players of color being subjected to these things. When you mention Etihad, clearly Mansoor and NYCFC has been a talking point. When you mention Chick-fil-A, clearly the MLS had that issue with the Boy Scouts of America. Trying to determine where that line is difficult. And again, I know Chick-fil-A has risen to the, has risen into the popular culture because of the issues and because they're a private company, not publicly owned. But when do those attitudes of one or two individuals, and this has happened in California with someone who was kicked off a board, and I can't remember who it was. Somebody was kicked off a board for holding anti-marriage equality opinions, and I can't remember who it was. But where is the line between this is the company and this is the belief, and how do we, who embodies what here? That's an interesting discussion, which I don't think we're going to determine the answer to. But again,
you make a valid point. I think the word you're using there, line, is very important because, of course, MLS, for example, has the Don't Cross the Line campaign. But at what point is it actual action to adjust society, and at what point is it social justice as a form of marketing? And I think that's the line that Neymar is on right now. And the question becomes whether you think he actually believes that.
Okay.
And he's using his marketing muscle.
I don't think that's fair. I don't think that part's fair, Rick. I mean, maybe you can consider that. I don't think it's fair. But I will say this. Neymar is in a difficult position because if he's going to participate, now he could come out and say something that probably would be more impactful. It would mean more if he was out there talking about it. But he is in a difficult position because by his very nature, he is a marketing tool. Just his being is a marketing thing. Anything he does social media wise is marketing, whether he means for it to be that way or not. So when I think it's the element of the PR firm, which may turn some people off. This isn't organic. This isn't something that Neymar thought about first. This is something that his PR firm, and do you take credit away from him for signing on to the plan if it wasn't his idea. I mean, again, that's a distraction we probably shouldn't even bother with, because again, that doesn't get to the real issue. We can argue whether or not we are all monkeys and the banana eating Instagrams are trivializing the racism. That's important. But we shouldn't. I'm not going to waste time wondering if Neymar's heart is in the right place. I'm more concerned about how football deals with this, so that Dani Alves doesn't have to worry about another banana ever, or a monkey chant, because that's happened. And I got plenty of people. Gringo Mark is filling me in. Apparently, Mexico has had monkey chant incidents, and I'm not. I just wasn't aware of that. And again, these are things that just can't happen. And every time somebody says zero tolerance and then doesn't follow through on zero tolerance, it just strengthens the core of people who believe that they're always going to be able to get away with this.
And the larger problem is, until you have leadership in football from the club level, the league level, the federation level, and in FIFA that has moral authority and moral accountability, there's no way they can enforce that, because there's always going to be more money in not doing it than doing it.
Yeah. Again, I mean, I don't pretend to know how difficult the choices are when it comes to management and decision makers having to address these issues. I mean, this is still, MLS may not have racial abuse incidents in the league, on the field, bananas and chants and those kind of things. But what we do have are questions over profanity in the stands. We certainly have questions over the goalkeeper chants, whether it's YSA or the Spanish version, which has yet to be addressed, as far as I know, actively by the league. And again, do you say, well, we're going to stop playing the games until you stop doing this chant, which features one offensive word, or we're, you know, again, where's the line, Rick?
Well, I think there is a fundamental difference between, you know, generic cursing and racial epithets.
No, sure. Yes.
Racist,
yes.
Demonstration.
Yes.
But no, you make a valid point. And that line, I mean, it does have to be cultural to an extent. But when we're dealing with an international sport, when we're dealing with an international society, at some point there has to be an absolute right and wrong. There has to be an absolute respect for everyone who is playing the game and everyone in the stands. And yeah, that's an idealized world. But if you set the guidelines as FIFA claims they have, then the guidelines have to be followed. And if it's zero tolerance, then yeah, go ahead, dock points, suspend games, allow players to walk off, and support the players when they do. If there's no games to go to, the fans will change their behavior.
Yeah. The burden is on the organizers. The burden is on the people who hold the power and the money. That's where the burden should lie. At the same time, I can't help but wish, and we just got done talking about the NBA players considering a boycott, which they didn't need to follow through with because the person with the power brought their hammer down. But I kind of the opinion that I wouldn't mind at all if Dani Alves, and I would hope that every single one of his Barcelona teammates, black or otherwise, would follow him in walking off the field to make that grand statement. It shouldn't be on him, but it's probably going to take action by someone like him in order for anybody to start taking this seriously. Again, when Kevin Prince Boateng made his action, that was January of last year, 2013, I believe. When he decided to walk off the field in the face of racial chants in a friendly against a small club in Italy, there were players on the field, his teammates, telling him not to do it. That can't be. I mean, I know Italian, this again speaks to Italian culture, if those are Italian players, but that's a fundamental problem. We need to come to a clear conclusion that if a player is being racially abused and he walks off the field, that's his right. That's certainly a justifiable action, and really probably the only thing that's going to get anybody's attention at this point.
I think what it's going to take is a player of the stature of a Messi or a Ronaldo or a Zlatan walking off in support of one of his teammates. I think that's the only thing that's going to have that kind of impact, and the only players who have the kind of stature to command the 24-hour news cycle long enough to affect change.
It's troubling. It's again, there's not going to be an easy answer, and I continue to struggle with the fact that you are not going to change thinking with these actions. But what you can do, and what the minimum should be for FIFA and anybody running a league or a competition, is to make the environment as equal and as fair and as non-racist as possible and non-homophobic as possible and not all of these things, because that's not what the game should be about.
Jason, let me ask you something before I duck off. What's going to happen the first time a supporters group or a fan tries to bring a Confederate battle flag to an Atlanta MLS?
Well, I hate to say it this way, but I hope that they don't do that. And I hope that, and if it does happen, I suppose it's a, I don't know. I mean, is it unfair for the team and the league to kind of put out there, don't do this right away? Before a game is played, before a fan ever shows up, are you sort of disrespecting that fan base who may never have conceived of the idea by putting it out there? Are you being unfair to the people who live in Atlanta, whatever their background is? Or do you cross that bridge when you come to it and deal with it swiftly and hopefully effectively? I don't know.
It's going to be compelling to watch.
Yeah, absolutely. Rick and Philly with your some insights into that. I appreciate your phone call, Rick. You did save me. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
All right, there you go. There's Rick. Let's shift gears here. I mean, again, this is heavy stuff, and I admit that it's heavy stuff. I think it's important. I think it's part of the reason Soccer Morning exists, so we can have these discussions. We've got about 12 minutes until we grab Herculez Gomez, get him on the line, have him discuss life playing in Tijuana, any thoughts on MLS. Want to ask him specifically about the way that MLS is progressing as he sort of is able to view it from a removed perspective, having played in the league. I think that's fascinating. The LA Galaxy Tijuana rivalry, if that's what that is. Is it? Is it a rivalry? Does Tijuana think of it as a rivalry? Is it just about maximizing their influence in Southern California, grabbing fans, getting players out of Southern California? Because they think of it as their territory. Do they have an actual rivalry with the Galaxy? And obviously, Herc played for the Galaxy. Let's talk about financial fair play for just a couple of minutes here. I mentioned, I think it was last week, both City and Manchester City and Paris Saint-Germain were said to have been in violation of financial fair play. That they had gone around the rules that tie revenue to spending, as outlined by these new set of rules in Europe. And I suggested that if there wasn't a willingness to swing a big hammer on this regard in relation to financial fair play, then what's the point? What's the point of having the rules if you're not going to fundamentally punish these teams for breaking them? Now, I've come to understand financial fair play just a little bit more. And I'll admit that this is, it's a dense subject. It's not the most accessible stuff for football fans, for soccer fans, when we're looking at what's going on in Europe. What's financial fair play? What does it do? What's the point? Is it just about keeping teams from going under? Is it meant to curb debt? What's the point? Thanks to Richard Whittle at The Score, the counterattack blog at The Score, I have a little bit of a better understanding, and this makes a lot of sense. Richard outlines that financial fair play is less about punishing teams for violating the rules than it is about pulling back a little bit on those transfer fees that have gotten out of control. And that there's a thought behind the program that by putting these rules in place, and again, tying revenue to spending, turnover, whatever you want to call that, that clubs are less likely to go out and spend all of this insane money driving up transfer fees. And again, that's what puts teams in debt, trying to compete with everybody else by means of paying these insane transfer fees. I'm looking for the piece here. I'm trying to find exactly what Richard outlines, because again, it's, here we go. Why FFP isn't meant to punish clubs like Manchester City and Paris Saint-Germain. He outlines how the public's understanding of financial fair play is roughly that FFP exists to ensure clubs pay their bills, don't spend more money than they earn, so they don't do another Leeds, and also to prevent certain clubs from cheating by spending wealthy owner money on players, which is what would be the case with Manchester City and PSG. But it's more it's more about, again, affecting those wage inflation and transfer fee prices going up. Here's the key paragraph, or at least what I'm going to hope is the key paragraph. Though UEFA's break-even rules will be rendered less effective should clubs avoid consequences for violating them. The point of financial fair play isn't to punish clubs. The point of financial fair play, rather, is to slow both player transfer fees and wage inflation. So there you go. I was going to make a comparison to something happening in this country. I'm not going to do that. But apparently PSG and Manchester City are going to get settlements. They're going to get deals. They're not going to get any significant punishment. Now, if we go along with Richard's explanation, and I'm sure he's right, that this is more about controlling the market than it is about punishing these clubs, then that's not really that big of a deal. And again, it's not like Manchester City or Paris Saint-Germain are going to go under because they're spending at this level. They have wealthy owners with bottomless pockets who can go and buy all of these players and not have it affect the club's long-term health. That's not the case for smaller clubs. So maybe if there is another Leeds, not a small club, but doesn't have a big-time super rich owner right now anyway. I don't know who owns Leeds. That's always seemed to be a mystery. I don't really know who owns Leeds right now. But this Reuters piece that came out today, or yesterday, as a matter of fact, sort of talks about the issues with the perceptions of financial fair play and what Paris Saint-Germain and Manchester City getting around significant punishment does to that perception. Financial fair play struggles to live up to its name. UEFA to shy away from toughest sanctions for loss makers. Move will fuel criticism that big clubs get off lightly. Repeat offenders could be hit harder next year. And your lead says the credibility of European soccer's financial fair play rules will be questioned after it emerged that Manchester City and Paris Saint-Germain will not be banned from Champions League for breaching them. They have been offered settlements for breaking rules designed to limit clubs' financial losses, and those agreements could be rubber-stamped as early as this week. The punishments likely to be meted could include fines or limits on the size of squads that clubs can field in Champions League matches next season, but a ban is not believed to be on the agenda. So again, I mean, I think we have, if you are not a Manchester City fan, if you are not a PSG fan, if you're not a Chelsea fan, if you're not a fan of a team that has seen a gigantic injection of cash by an owner who is among the top 15 or 20 richest people in the world, and that seems to be the case whenever a new club challenges. If you're not a fan of one of those teams, maybe you're calling for the hammer. Like, what is going on here? Why even bother putting in these rules if you're not going to enforce them with significant punishment? What kind of deterrent is financial fair play if Manchester City and PSG get off lightly? Oh, you can't field three play. You know, your squad is limited by three players in the Champions League next year. I'm pulling that out. I don't know if that's the number. I'm making that up. But even that doesn't seem, three seems like a lot, but it doesn't seem like a lot. Certainly not in relation to violation of the rules that UEFA put in place. So I think our instinct is ban them. Bring it down. They're breaking the rules. It's unfair. Well, that's not really what European soccer is concerned with. They're not concerned with the lack of fairness in how the competitions run. If they were concerned about how fair things were, there would be salary caps. There would be limits on spending. Manchester City wouldn't be able to go out and spend £300 million on player signings. They wouldn't be able to have a payroll of whatever it is, insanity, £200 million. PSG wouldn't be able to go out and spend all the money they did. Those controls aren't in place because UEFA is not concerned necessarily with holding these big clubs back, holding these rich clubs back. Apparently, they are concerned about the rising cost of everything for everybody, which, justifiable, understandable approach. let's go and control out of control spending. Let's go try to get a handle on that first. I can understand where that's coming from. But again, I think the issue is the disconnect between the perception of financial fair play and what it's actually meant to do. It's going to cause a lot of confusion. I was confused. I hold up my hand. I was confused as to what financial fair play was supposed to be about. And then somebody explained it to me. But not everybody's going to go and look for that information. People are going to go, hey, wait a second. These are rules. These clubs are violating them. What is the punishment? And maybe this speaks to a sense of nostalgia, a sense of fairness for a lot of soccer fans. If your club is not rich in petrodollars, if your club is not Manchester City, PSG, Chelsea, etc., then you want your team to be able to compete in a more fair fashion. And I suppose that financial fair play actually gets you to that, being able to afford better players because transfer fees will be under better control than they were before, if financial fair play is effective. I believe that Richard's piece at The Score outlines that, in effect, that financial fair play has been effective on some level. I'll read the finishing paragraph here. Again, go read this. The Score, the counterattack blog at The Score. Maybe we can share the link on Twitter. Again, if the point of financial fair play was to primarily ensure clubs paid their bills and their earnings fair and square with their earnings fair and square, then why exempt anything at all, no matter how beneficial? And previous to this paragraph, outlined how the rules exclude expenses incurred for healthy investments, such as improving the stadiums, training facilities, or academy, which would lead to losses in the short term, but would be beneficial for the club in the long term. The fact that financial fair play specifically targets transfer fee and wage spending is another indication of its broader, far more important aim to slow wage and transfer fee inflation. Are you cool with that? Are you cool with that being the goal? All right, let's take a break. When we come back, excited for this, Herculez Gomez will join us. Soccer Morning, North American Soccer Network, NASN.TV. Don't go anywhere.
Welcome back to Soccer Morning on NASN with Jason Davis.
Back on Soccer Morning. Little Elton John there, courtesy of John Tannenwald, who has picked our music for today, all of them. I heard he picked more than his fair share, but that's what we're playing. And we are going to play a song that's not a Jonathan Tannenwald song, because I have to introduce, on the line with me now, Herculez Gomez, U.S. International, Tijuana player, all-around great guy. Follow him on Twitter. One of the best players on Twitter out there, Herculez Gomez. Herc, how are you, sir?
I'm doing well. How are you doing?
I'm good. This music is was requested specifically for you. This is why it's just going to build up to your introduction here. Playing on the team. You don't have to. It seems I don't get down anymore. Okay. We'll get rid of that. Yeah, it sets the mood. I think it is. It's a sexy song for a sexy guy. I have no problem saying that. So, Herc, thanks very much for taking the time, man. I really do appreciate it. Again, I think your Twitter game is on point, and I got to ask you, how part of the reason you're here is because of Twitter. How many times have you thought about, I got to get off Twitter?
Well, I mean, every once in a while I get in trouble for opening my mouth on Twitter, so it definitely crosses my mind. But no, Twitter is a great platform. It's a great way to reach out to people and fans, and for them to, you know, get a chance to see kind of who I am, you know, off the field. Because what I do, you know, in my life on the field is a very small part of who I am. So I think it's fun. It's a good way for people to interact and get to know each other. And as long as you keep it respectful and, you know, there's good banter on it, there's no problem.
How does, you know, like, you've been on Twitter for a while and it's a major part of your persona. As you said, it lets people get to know who Herculez Gomez is, because when you're running around on the field for 90 minutes, that's not exactly a window into your personality. But how do the clubs that you've played for, how have they responded to your have you ever had anybody at a club specifically say something about your Twitter account?
Oh yeah, absolutely. Not only club, you know, I think anytime I go into any type of marketing opportunity, my Twitter platform is something that they specify on that they want to use, and the club hasn't been any different. You know, when I was at Santos, they were really keen on me being proactive and a heavy user on Twitter. And, you know, I think it was a great way to get fans involved. And we used to do a lot of things where, I don't know if you guys remember, but we played a couple times against Seattle and Toronto and CONCACAF. And, you know, my club reached out to me and they were like, it'd be great for you to interact with fans on Twitter for this tournament, because since CONCACAF did most of the marketing, it was hard for them to try to get people out. And, you know, a buddy of mine on the team and myself, we ended up purchasing about 1,000 tickets each.
Wow.
And we did this little Twitter campaign and then make sure those tickets got to the right hands and brought fans out to those games. And it was a lot of fun.
That's very cool. I mean, I guess then in a way, not only is Twitter an opportunity for you to interact with fans and for people to get to know you, but you are conscious of, you know, the marketing aspects of it and sort of setting yourself up as being more than just Herculez Gomez soccer player.
I know it doesn't look like it, but very little of what I've done has been by accident. So it's premeditated. There is reason behind all this chaos. It's fun. I actually enjoy it. You know, believe it or not, I enjoy doing these live tweets during Champions League games. I enjoy doing these Q&As. I enjoy interacting with fans. Sometimes because you can anonymously tweet things or say things online, it gets out of hand for some people, because they feel there are no consequences to what they say. But, you know, those are very few and far between, those times, those moments. So I enjoy it. It's been a lot of fun. It makes these kind of stressful days, these, you know, as a soccer player, I'm going to be honest, we don't really have a ton of work. But there is a ton of pressure. There is a ton of things going on externally. So it does kind of relieve some of that. It does kind of get your mind away from things like that.
Now, playing in Tijuana, and you've been in Mexico for a while, obviously everybody knows your MLS history, but playing in Tijuana, a club that has sort of actively you know, tried to grab some of the American market, obviously San Diego's right there, and there's plenty of American players, Mexican-American players on the team that give it that cross-cultural vibe. What's that been like, and how has that sort of changed? Has that changed at all how people relate to you on Twitter? I mean, when you're playing at Santos, that's a little different for, like, U.S. men's national team fans, I imagine, than if you're playing at Tijuana with a bunch of other guys and a team that's got an American vibe to it.
Right. Well, you know, absolutely. We do embrace the dual culture that people live out here, being so close to the border. But I think it's just San Diego, and I'm not really sure how people take that on Twitter. But it is different than when I was in Torreon and Santos. Mm. You know, Santos is an amazing club. The fans are amazing. It's one of those places where they live, breathe, and you know, die with results. And it's crazy. I remember hearing a stat that if Santos loses a game that week, and domestic violence goes up, you know, like twofold. You know, it's something that's really crazy. It's not so dramatic out here because of the way of life. I mean, you got so many different things. You know, people cross the border, come see Tijuana. For them, it's an outlet. For them, it's something fun to call their own. You know, people in San Diego, you know, I feel like sometimes the sports teams feel left out. You know, they have the Chargers, and I'm a big Raiders fan, so I don't mind kind of cheering for the Chargers because I think it's like the lesser of the evils in the AFC West. But other than that, they don't have, you know, a basketball team.
Right.
The baseball team sometimes isn't taken seriously. So to have a team that's done so much in such so little time in a sport where for them it's of relevance, you know, I think it's been great. And to have people that they can relate to, you know, Joe Corona, Edgar Castillo, Greg Garza, Paul Ariola, myself, where they can say, hey, I was just like that kid, you know, I have something to aspire to. I think for them it's been great. You know, the reception I've received here, the reception I've gotten here is amazing. I live in San Diego. I commute every day to work. You know, if I'm in TJ or San Diego, I've never had a negative thing said to me by people outside the soccer field. I think they're very conscious sports fans and they're very good people, and you don't always find that. So it's been fun.
Now the, you know, a lot is made of sort of the battleground that exists there in the area with Southern California being so rich for soccer, and the notion that, and obviously Paul Ariola sort of embodies this, and I wonder how he takes that, by the way, and being a teammate, when you witness sort of him, he, you know, he gets written about, but it's not necessarily Paul Ariola the player, and he's a good, very, very good player. It's about Paul Ariola as this embodiment of the battle between Tijuana and LA and kids in Southern California having choices to make and being quote unquote poached. How is all of that within the club? Are you guys talking? Do you guys talk about that stuff? Is that honestly top of mind when you're going out about your business and in the league and now in the playoffs?
I don't think so much by the players. I think guys like Paul and Greg, they're kind of like the new player. You know, I think guys like Jose Torres and myself, we were kind of those pioneers. And, you know, it's for us. We've been there. We've seen that. I've been to other clubs, and it doesn't matter what club I've been on. I've had a young Chicano player come up to me that's been trying out in third division or second division, and you know, wants to get to know me. And all these players are everywhere within the youth systems out here in Mexico. And I think Cholos is one of the teams that actually, you know, are putting clout on these players. They understand this player is an important player in the future of CONCACAF soccer. You know, it's a player that has a choice. That can mold really either a national team. I mean, you're talking about the Benji Hoyas are coming up. You're talking about the Paul Ariolas. I don't know if they understand the relevance, but I can tell you that Mexican soccer understands the relevance. I can tell you that, you know, the Major League Soccer now understands the relevance. You know, both national teams understand that it is a battle. Before I came to Tijuana, it was around the time I finally negotiated my contract and, you know, I was going to come out here. The team owner and the president sat me down and, you know, told me how they wanted me to be a mentor to these young kids and how they wanted me to kind of take them under my wing. And they really felt it was going to be an important part of their future, Cholos' future. So they understand what's going on. And I think it's about time people started seeing the relevance in this because it is going to be an important part of the CONCACAF future.
I imagine, is there, obviously we just had the Champions League matchup between Tijuana and LA, and you know, I think it's easy for people to see rivalry where maybe it doesn't exist, especially if one team wants to pump it up. And there was some notion that maybe LA was fostering a rivalry that wasn't necessarily there, at least in terms of the two clubs. Did you guys feel that when you played LA in the Champions League?
No, obviously, being an MLS team in this competition, you always want to win against the Mexican team, but that's you know, same set for the Mexican teams. I think more than anything, whether it be Tijuana players or LA Galaxy players, I think it's both front offices really want this to be a rivalry, really want it really bad.
Right.
That's just the truth. Yeah. It's a great marketing play for both teams. You know, this Mexico versus USA, this neighborly, you know, rivalry going on, it is what it is. I think for the players, you want to win. And I know for now being on both sides of this, because I look at it from a club standpoint when I played with Santos playing against MLS teams in this competition, and now a national team, you know, because I played with the U.S. playing against Mexico, it is USA-Mexico. It is a rivalry. You almost feel, I almost got a sense, you know, I've wondered a couple of times. I've been in those Santos locker room and the Tijuana locker room when you're talking about these MLS teams, and they do treat it as USA. So it makes me wonder if when I'm about to play Mexico, if the same thing is being said, you know, about our national team, it makes you feel like you're inside, and it is a heated rivalry, you know. You definitely do not want to lose to each other.
Now, it brings me to the point, and this is, you know, look, MLS teams fell flat in this tournament once again, and it didn't go well, and Mexico's, you know, Cruz Azul is lifting the trophy, and this is the 1,000th straight year that a Mexican team has won the regional trophy. That's a fact of life for these MLS teams, that they have trouble competing. So I got to ask you, as a guy who, again, has been on both sides of this, and maybe MLS has changed a little bit since you left, but I'm sure you're in tune with what's going on. How does MLS compete with the Liga MX teams in this competition?
Well, first of all, I've obviously been away from MLS for a while, and it has changed completely since I've left. I think what MLS has done is tremendous. I don't think too many leagues can boast what they've done like MLS can. That being said, I do feel that they're still behind in certain factors, and depth being a huge one. I think you see these games going on. I mean, it's a two-game series, 180 minutes, and I've experienced this, you know, for my Santos days when you play against Toronto and Seattle. You come and you play in Toronto, you play in Seattle, and maybe you tie or maybe you lose. And they're good players, and they feel very comfortable playing at home. But to bring them back into Mexico, into a hostile environment that they're not used to playing in, with all due respect to Seattle, which is a great place to play in, it's not so much a hostile environment. You bring them back to a place like Torreon with the fans on you, with the conditions, with the importance of the game, these away goals, and all of a sudden they have an injury or two, maybe a guy's not on their game, and they don't have the depth. They're tested at times, and Mexican teams can take advantage of that. I mean, out here you have maybe 18 guys that compete, 20 guys that can compete, and in the MLS, on their day, any 9-10 guys can compete. But if any of those guys aren't on their day, and then you have a few injuries, you get tested. You slot in some players that are maybe not used to playing, and you know, at this level, at this stage of the game, one player that's not in it, two, you know, you're done.
Does that explain the epic immediate collapse of LA in TJ, or does that explain what happened to Sporting when they went away to Cruz Azul? I mean, that to just get blitzed from the very outset, you would think at least you have this idea of let's be smart and play safe and at least keep guys in front of us. No, go.
Well, it is what it is. You're also playing against a very good team.
Right.
And people can talk about the salaries and whatnot. I mean, the reality is, if you look at both rosters, the LA roster and TJ roster, I wasn't wrong when I said I feel that they have a higher salary than ours. The only thing is ours is more evenly dispersed amongst the players. I mean, the reality is we don't have one player that earns $6 million on our team or $4 million on our team.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the reality of things. But we've got guys who in their own right have done things, have made a career for themselves, and know what this is about. You know, we're used to playing in those hostile environments. Sometimes we play in those hostile environments at home. You know, that's just the reality of things. I mean, our fans are demanding. I've learned how to play through pressure. I've learned how to play through that kind of hostile being, you know, where you know that you're in for a dogfight. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's not just about playing football. Sometimes it's about getting over something mentally. And, you know, it is what it is. Sometimes in the MLS, you don't face that. It doesn't mean that they're not good players, they're not good teams, they're not good franchises. It's just the reality of what things are.
Yeah, look, I when you were talking about salaries, I remember that on Twitter. And again, the Galaxy go out and spend $16 million in total salary, but three players make like $12 million of it. That obviously means that there's not enough quality across the quality of the roster. And so that gets me to the point of, you know, as MLS has changed, yeah, it's changed in a lot of good ways, Herc, but there's still this idea that they've sort of sold out to the notion of a couple of stars on each team while the rest of the quality suffers a bit. How does MLS, I mean, is it just a matter of like, let's get rid of the DP and you can go spend $10 million on your whole team? I mean, how does MLS fix that? And really, I guess this gets us to the CBA, because the players are going to come up to negotiate against the owners in a couple of months, and I don't know what's going to happen, because I'm afraid the owners are going to say, well, we don't want to spend any more money. We're already spending on these DPs, and the players are going to say, well, this isn't really working for us.
Like, yeah, you could say that. I mean, MLS is well within the right saying, look, we've invested a lot of money, and the players are well within the right saying, well, you know, we've put in a lot of man hours. We, you know, we're definitely underpaid for our professions, and
right.
You know, it will be interesting. How do you fix that? I don't know. If I knew, I'd be running the, I'd be the head of the negotiations for the CBA. I'd be on the, working. Doing
would you?
Playing.
Nah, you wouldn't be. You'd still be playing, but I maybe you've got a future that with that. But I guess that I'm asking you, if you were that guy, if you were responsible for sort of setting the line, and I mean, so there's a lot of information you don't have at your disposal. But I know you talk to guys. Where's the line? What do the players demand that they think they can get? I mean, full free agency, is that on the table again?
Well, look, if I ever catch up with an old friend from the MLS, the last thing we talk about is
CBA
negotiations. But in all fairness, these things are never easy. I remember what it was like last time, and it was around the same time I left the league. They're not easy. They're tense moments. I wish them both the best, because I think what they've done with the league has been amazing. I'm still an MLS fan. I have friends there, so I hope it goes the players' way. But the reality thing is you do need to increase things like salary cap. You do need to increase things like homegrown players. You do need to have the league investing more in younger players that they can, not so much, I guess, aging superstars, but players that bring in more quality. Because at the end of the day, you bring in more quality, it's going to raise the level for everybody. That's just my opinion. But I do understand there are things that need to be done for the league to keep going the way it's going. Because, you know, you can sit here and talk about, you know, soccer being fourth, fifth, you know, sixth biggest sport in the country. But reality of things is the league is growing. The league is viable. Mm-hmm. It's a league that everybody wants in if you're an owner, because you're not going to be losing money. You pull your money in. So whatever you lose together, and whatever you win together. It's from an owner standpoint, it's a great investment. So hopefully the players can work something out, because I think they have everything at their disposal.
You know, what's fascinating to me, Herc, is to think about how MLS is sort of behind the eight ball in this country when it comes to soccer. Yeah, it's the local domestic league, and there's a lot of things going for it. And I'm not like bemoaning the state of MLS or anything. But you get the Premier League every weekend, which is getting major attention. NBC's dumping a lot of money. Obviously, the Mexican League is hugely popular in this country, and it's sort of this idea that MLS is third in its own country. I don't know if there's a fix for that, but that's got to be something that sort of impacts how we all think about where this league is and is going, right?
Not necessarily. I think those numbers are deceiving. I think if you talk, the Premier League is wildly popular. But they're wildly popular because of their marketing. They're wildly popular because, you know, they spend very little time investing in the English game. You know, you talk about how they're suffering. Their national team kind of gets put in the back burner because they want to play an unlimited amount of foreigners. And, you know, that's not always the best thing. They end up suffering. Yeah, it's good for the fan. Aesthetically, it's pleasing. But it's not necessarily something that I see as a viable option to keep their national team busy or keep their national team progressing. MLS has done an awesome job of growing the league and being, you know, kind of a feeder or I guess a base for the national team now.
Mm-hmm.
Any of these players that come up to the national team from MLS can play with any player in the world. The problem is consistency. You know, you talk about the Mexican league, it's the same thing. they're now raising the number of foreigners that can play, saying it used to be 5 years or 10 seasons because there's two in every year, mm-hmm. and you get Mexican citizenship to play, and you're counted as a Mexican. Now it's 2 years. So I think Mexico is going to be heading in the direction of the Premier League. Will it affect the national team? I think so. Mm-hmm. I think so, but it's one of those things. It's apples and oranges. You just can't really compare. You can say it is the third most popular, I guess, spectacle for soccer fans in the U.S., but it's such a large demographic, I don't really think it matters.
Right. I mean, it's a vast community of soccer fans. It takes all kinds anyway, and I don't know. It's interesting. While we're talking about the Premier League, I wanted to get your perspective on this. We've got the Champions League, obviously, and we just got done with Chelsea beating Liverpool in the Premier League, and doing it in this way that Brendan Rodgers called parking two buses, obviously. When it comes to defensive soccer, Jose Mourinho is kind of a genius that way. As a player, and I know I'm sure you've been in plenty of positions where a coach has said, we're going to bunker, we're going to sit back, we're going to wait for our chance, but we're going to defend first. As a striker, as a guy who's asked to do, I don't know, I mean, whatever their responsibilities are in that setup, what's that like, and how much different is it than, say, let's go attack, let's go at them, and is it a matter of liking one or the other? Is it just, you know, this is the job I've got today?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's definitely the job I got today. Look, I love, more than anything, I'm a competitor. I love competing. I love winning. But more than loving winning is I hate losing. So whatever the coach feels is our best chance of winning, I'm going to do it. You know, I'm going to be... And I feel the majority of players are the same way. You have to have that winning mentality. So if, you know, Jose Mourinho thinks that you're 10 minutes in behind the ball and you wait and you're patient and you shift and each one has a responsibility, the best way to get an outcome, that's what they're going to do. And you've got superstars. You've got superstars that he makes buy into this philosophy. This is a man who absolutely knows 100% of the time going in what he wants out of this game, you know, how he's going to approach it. And I think it's a lot easier when you buy into what the coach is asking you to do. Sometimes it's not the most aesthetically pleasing thing on earth. Mm. Sometimes it's very frustrating for opposing players and fans. But, you know, it is a reality of things. I think you have to cater to your team. When I remember my first season at Santos, you couldn't ask us to play that way. You had to ask us to attack. That season we were the super leaders. It was just kind of like the supporters shield winners, and we won the final, and we played in two finals, the CONCACAF final as well, and it was, okay, they may score two or three goals on us, but we're going to score five.
Right.
It was that kind of game for us, but that's because we had that kind of player. We had that player at our disposal. I think it's all about who you have at your disposal. You can't just make any player buy into any system.
There's this idea, though, of there being a right way to play and a wrong way to play, and negative football is the wrong way to play, and shame on Jose, and shame on whoever. Obviously, there's other factors involved. I mean, Jose Mourinho might get away with it a little bit more than a smaller club with a manager who's not as respected. But do you buy any of that? That, look, I mean,
absolutely not. I think it's garbage. I mean, I don't think you can discredit the way to play and say it's parking the bus. I didn't read one comment yesterday or hear from any teammate or anything like that, that Real Madrid was parking the bus.
Right.
I mean, I don't think there's any difference between the way Real Madrid defended yesterday and the way Chelsea defended against Atletico. I think there's a big difference in what they do after they defend and when they win the ball.
Right.
But in their defensive scheme, I don't think there was much of a difference. I mean, you're talking about guys being compact, you know, limiting those spaces in between the lines, and when they get the ball, break. The only difference is Real Madrid's got some track stars, and when they get the ball, there's three or four breaking at you at an incredible pace. That's the only difference for me.
Yeah, I mean, the difference is Ronaldo and Bale. That's insanity when those guys are running the break. I guess I'm completely with you. I don't know that there's an intrinsically right way or wrong way to play. We get that whole debate about this is entertainment. And we've seen managers fired for playing, for even if they win or get decent results, especially considering whatever the expectations are, but fired for playing ugly football. Is that, I mean, I suppose it's within the prerogative of the fans to be upset if their team's not playing the right kind of soccer, but that's just, again, it's sort of a strange notion that you're going to fire a guy who might be successful because he's not playing the right type of football.
Yeah, I mean, with you bring in players and you bring in coaches to win, you know, bottom line. And, you know, I think we're all within our right to want to be entertained. But I think there's much more to sport than being entertained. I think everybody loves a winner. You know, Jose Mourinho, for everything, you know, he's entertainment. You know, that defensive structure may not be the most aesthetically pleasing on the field, but it is entertainment. You know, you're in for a dogfight. You have to think of different ways to break him down. He's a master tactician. He's not the only one who uses those tactics. It is what it is. It's a different way of playing the game. Mm-hmm. Is it right or wrong? I mean, that's pretty much, I guess, a personal question for everybody. You know, it's pretty much what your preference of what you want to see, what you enjoy. Sure. But I enjoy seeing the winner. I enjoy seeing guys committed to their goal. I enjoy seeing everybody buying into it. And I enjoy hearing, you know, these reactions after the game.
Yeah, it's also this thing like, you know, obviously when the USA beats Spain in 2009 or Switzerland beats Spain or some of these other Barcelona gets beaten by a team that bonkers or parks the bus, that, you know, you could argue whether or not the better team won, but like it somehow takes away from the victory. Like they didn't do the job necessary to win, or they shouldn't have won. They didn't deserve to win. Herc, I don't get that. The deserve thing. If you do the job and you stop the other team from scoring, you deserve to win.
That's exactly right. I mean, I don't deserve a majority of what I have because I play a sport for a living, but that's the world we live in, you know?
Yeah,
it's the reality of things. It is what it is. I think everybody has their own idea of what good soccer is or a good brand of football is, but at the end of the day, you know, it's still 11v11. Mm-hmm. It's still the same dimension of the field. It's still one ball for everybody, you know? You can say, oh, but they didn't have, tactically, their game is terrible. What's tactically, you know?
Yeah.
Technically, it's very different from tactically. Yeah. So, you know, it's a choice. It's preference more than anything.
We're out of time. Could do this all day. Herculez Gomez, obviously you know him, Herculez G on Twitter. If you're not following, I don't know what's wrong with you. Herc, I appreciate the time. I know it's relatively early out there in San Diego. I imagine you've got a full day ahead of you. Appreciate it, man.
No problem, guys.
All right, thanks a lot. Herculez Gomez joining us on Soccer Morning. We got like a minute left. Just remind you, soccermorning.com is where you can go to help support the show. We are on Twitter, Soccer Morning. 96%, I'm being told, of the monthly goal. So you guys have done a fantastic job. Thank you very much. Brilliant. And I have to give Milena some zap for helping get Herc on the air. I know she played a role in getting Herculez to show up on the program today, and appreciate her as well. Thanks to Jonathan Tannenwald for the music. Trevor, what else am I missing? I feel like I'm missing something. It's Wednesday. Is there any soccer? Is there any MLS tonight? There's Chelsea and Atletico Madrid. Did we cover that enough? I don't know that I have done enough on that game. Now, I don't expect that to be as fun as Real Madrid and Bayern Munich, but it might be. Who knows? That's why you watch, because anything can happen. All right, that's going to do it for us. Soccer Morning, North American Soccer Network. Yeah, what will Jose wear? That's a good question. North American Soccer Network, NASN.TV. Thanks a lot for listening, guys. Thanks to Jonathan Tannenwald for the music. We'll talk to you tomorrow. Bye.
It seems I don't get time out anymore. Oh, what a change if we set the pace face to face. No one even